Yeah, good afternoon. It's great to see so many people here. Thanks for attending. So today I want to show you how to build your own event loop from first principle. So we will look at a few async await examples, and we will build an event loop from a simple event loop from first principle, and then we will look at a few examples from other libraries. I'm Pradip Caulagi. I'm from India. I have been living in Stockholm for 3 years. I have been working with Python for more than 10 years. I mostly develop web applications. I like to spend my free time by watching chess online. It's mostly made possible due to noise cancelling headphones, like headphones with noise cancellation. And I'm at Caulagi on Twitter and GitHub, so feel free to send me a message. I work as a backend engineer at Starstable. We are a gaming company based entirely out of Stockholm. We have a game for young children. They can have a horse and have adventures in the game. We have 14 million registered users, more than 200 EC2 instances. The game is written in C++, of course, but all the backend systems are written in Python, and more than 50% of this backend is written in Python 3. I want to give a shout out to Alexia. She's listened to my rants and half-assed preparation and like helped me refine my thoughts. So we want to look at building applications which can handle many users efficiently. So we are essentially talking about apps which are I/O bound, meaning they spend a lot of time waiting for requests to happen over network, or it could be sockets. We want to wait for sockets to be able to read or write, or it could be, say, file operations. So we want to do this efficiently, but we also want to do it correctly, in the sense that it should be easy to look at the code and reason about the behavior of the system. So any concurrency in the system should be easy to reason about, and concurrency should be explicit. So in some sense, we want to build a system like the well-behaved puppies on the left. So we will look at some async await examples. These are simple examples, but if that sounds boring, you can think of them as like serverless functions or microservices. So the async is a keyword that was introduced in Python 3.5, and the PEP was 492. I remember the PEP because it's hard to read and understand it at the first time. You have to read it multiple times. But async def are coroutines. And coroutines is not a function which is specific to Python. It's available in many languages like C, C++, Java, Scala, etc. And coroutines are essentially non-preemptive multitasking constructs. You can think of them as functions which can be suspended and resumed. And here we see that when we call greet, it just gives us a coroutine object back. It's actually not run the function. So coroutines are implemented with generators. Just let's quickly look at generators. So generators have been available in Python for a long time. These are functions which have the yield keyword. Here, countdown is a simple generator, and we can iterate on this and then get the next element. And eventually, when it runs out of items to give us back, we get a stop iteration, right? So we know the next, I think the next usage of this is using next to get the next element is well understood, but it's also possible to do the same iteration using send. Like we can call the send on this iterator to have the same behavior. And this is key to understanding coroutines in 3.5. Like I said, the async def is a coroutine. But a coroutine is not a generator because it does not implement dunder iter and dunder next. So the only message it understands is send. And in order to call greet or to make greet execute here, I have to call send on the coroutine. And as we saw in the generator example, it actually prints hello PyCon SE in this case, but also throws the stop iteration. But this is a common pattern to execute coroutines. So you can see this the run function that I've defined here. You can see it in almost all async libraries. And the run function here takes a coroutine as input and then calls the send on it. And at the bottom here, we eventually see how to actually run our coroutine. So the other idea that we need to understand is await. Await keyword is essentially allowing us to get the execution of a coroutine, like get the result from executing a coroutine. And you can use an await wherever you have a Python expression. Like in this case, for instance, I combine them together. I have mixed opinion about this example. Like it's kind of silly in some sense. Like I just call square root on square of a number, which is just the number. But if you think about it, the square root and the square methods could have been network calls, for instance. It could be waiting for IO in some sense to complete, and this code would just work without impacting the what's happening, like the other tasks in the system. Okay, so let's look at IO examples, like not 10 examples. I don't know if that scared you. So we will look at two examples where we'll build an event loop ground up. These are different from what I put in my conference proposal. And I hope it's not too disappointing, but I choose the examples because it's easier to illustrate the ideas. And also we can use the same, we can look at how these examples look in the other libraries that we want to look at. Is this visible? The first example will be a simple example. It's we want to write a program which computes the factorial of a number. So it takes input from a user. It takes a number as input and gives the factorial. But when it's not doing any computation, we want to do something in the background. So of course, naming is important, so we should call this a factorial microservice. Not sure how hard it will be to get funding, but yeah. So we want to read from standard in. Okay, this is kind of tricky to be able. And there's a new module in Python 3.4 called selectors. So I will explain why we use that in a bit. And then I have, so this, the run function here is what we have already seen. We have already seen this in the previous slide. So we want to have two functions. So this is what we want to do when nothing's happening, and when we get some input from the user, this is the factorial one. So we have these two functions. And then we want to take input from the user, but in a non-blocking fashion. That's where the selector module comes in. This provides us the default selector allows us to do I/O multiplexing. But it uses the best technique available on your system. So for instance, it chooses KQ or EPOL depending on what works better on your platform. And then we want to register an interest. So the default selector allows us to do I/O multiplexing, right? And we want to also register what we want to do. So we want to say from stdin, when there's a read event, I want to handle that input, for instance. So when the register, so the handle input is a callback that is called when there's something available for reading. And this can be a blocking call, because at this point we know there's something available for reading, so it need not be async. So read a line, compute the factorial. We use the run to actually execute that factorial, and then we can print the output. So we handle input when we get notified that there's something available for reading, but we also want to know when this should happen. So the way to do that is, so we can say check input, and what this does is, so this, when we do a select on the selector that we have, this will, for all the events that we have, so for instance here we have registered an interest in event read. So when that is available, it's when we are able to read events from stdin, for instance, that's available in events in this case. But this is a block. If we do not specify a timeout, this will just wait forever, because we want to say try to read. something, let me know if there's something available for reading, but time out after some 1 second, for instance. So if you set timeout 0, it will time out immediately. Like, so this would essentially be non-blocking. Like here we are saying wait for 1 second, check if there's something to read. This is just to get the callback out, this the handle input that we have put as our registered this one, and then we can call back. So this callback here is actually just handle input above. And then now we want to define an event loop here. This is also something you see in a lot of async libraries, run forever. So what this does is while true, see if there's any input that we have to handle. Otherwise, run this background task. And that's it. Like, this here is like the entire event loop where it says like if there's something to read, handle that input. Otherwise, do whatever you want to do. So the key ideas here are this, the selectors module, which allows us to register interest in what events we want to handle in a non-blocking manner. And then this loop here, which says what should happen for each iteration. We want to check if there's any input. So if we run this, so this is the function which just, like, I don't know, we could mine bitcoins or something here in this instead. Oh, okay. That number was too big. Let's try something smaller. Yeah. So we could look at a more let's say a more complete implementation of an event loop. So I have this echo server implementation. This was by a talk by David Beasley. I just want to illustrate the key ideas. Like, if you see at the import, you see that there's no dependencies here. We have looked at the selectors. The echo server is you listen on a socket, and clients can connect on the socket, and they can send messages, and you just send the message back. I will show it later. So the socket is just you're listening on a socket. The collections module, we use that for a fast list-like collection, DQ. Types coroutine, we have looked at coroutines, but we have looked at coroutines only when it's of the form async def. So this decorator is an alternate way to specify an asynchronous def. Like, these are similar, but you cannot use yield in async function. So we use that instead. And the key ideas here are okay. Let's just quickly go through this. So we have a loop. This is like an event loop. It does something all the time. We have three functions. Like, if you look at socket accept, all it is saying is when the socket is ready, do a sock accept. When there's something to receive on the socket here, for instance, the sock receive is just saying when there's something ready to receive. read that message, and then the sock send is similar. Yeah, we send the message, but the sock send here, like we try to send the entire message, but we want to see how much was actually sent, so we just do this in a loop. And then the run forever is the event loop that we saw from the previous example. We can start with this part here. So what this says is if there's a task which is ready, the self.ready has all the tasks that are now available to be run. So the second while loop is saying while we have some task which is ready to be run, run them. Like we have already seen this pattern, like we call a send on this coroutine. And this part, the selector select, is the one where we check if there's any IO which is ready to be processed since our previous iteration. Yeah, and then because this is a loop, we just do this forever till we say kill the process. We have already seen this construct as well, where we register some what we want to do. Like we want to register this current task as read and write, and then we have. So at the we can now look at the bottom. So the echo server, what it does is it creates a socket listening on port 9000. And then we wait for that socket to be ready to be able to accept connections. And the loop.create task, it just adds it to the ready queue here. It just adds that this task should be appended here. So what we say is, so we add this client as something that has to happen as a ready task for the loop implementation. So self.ready has the list of tasks that should be run, and we add this. We add the echo client as a ready task on this. So if we run this, this is listening on port 9000. So we could say connect on localhost. So, and then we could say open. We could do it again. So that was an event loop from first principles and like no dependencies. I thought it was a really elegant implementation by David Beasley, so I wanted to show that. So an event loop is a scheduler. All it does is it determines what has to happen next. This is the event loop that I took from the asyncio in Python. But we have already seen this, like each iteration of the loop, it calls all the currently ready callbacks. Once it's done this, it checks if there's any new IO that has to be handled, and then does the loop all over again. So how quickly we can go around this loop basically determines the throughput of the system. And it's important to remember that this is cooperative multitasking. Like if you look here, when we do this call here, the event loop yields the control to the callback. And it's important that the callback does its processing quickly and returns the control back to the event loop. Because this is, so in the examples that we looked, once the event loop hands the control, it's doing nothing. For the system to be very efficient or to have high throughput, it's important that this loop completes very quickly. Like we need to do the entire iteration as quickly as possible. So it's important that the callbacks do things efficiently and also yield control back to the event loop at regular intervals. So event loops are typically cooperative multitasking. You need to make sure that all the tasks in the system yield control at regular intervals. Of course, in a real application, we would not build an event loop ground up. It's very easy to get this wrong because there are a lot of subtleties. Like we need to handle timing, we need to handle timeouts, we need to handle canceling tasks. We need to be able to handle exceptions. It's very easy to get this wrong. So we would actually use one of these four options. These are the ones I know of. The asyncio is what we get out of the box with Python. And UV loop is it's a project which uses libuv as the event loop. So it's written in I think Cython, or it's written in C kind of I think it's written in C, but essentially what UV loop does is it provides bindings to libuv, which is what Node.js uses. And UV loop is completely API compatible with asyncio. So any program that works with asyncio also works with UV loop. And you can just change this event loop. Like you could just switch the loop from the one that you get with asyncio to UV loop and get a significant performance benefit. And Curio and Trio are two other projects which are very interesting. Curio provides low-level primitives. I think what the author says is this is a framework for other libraries to build applications on top of. And Trio is a library focused on usability and correctness. Like I said, there are a lot of ways to get this wrong, especially since things are happening asynchronously. We need to be able to handle timeouts and cancellation errors and like back pressure. So back pressure is when you're reading more than what you're writing in some sense on a socket, for instance. So it could be tricky to get these correct, and Trio instead takes the approach that usability and correctness is more important than sheer performance. I just want to show the same event loop echo server examples that we saw earlier in these. So asyncio and UV loop are similar, so let's just look at asyncio. And I want to show the echo server implementation in all three of them, but we'll not spend too much time because we haven't looked at a lot of the other constructs that are required to understand this. But the asyncio, like I said, it comes bundled with Python. It's got more constructs that we need to understand before we can use it. Like, for instance, we need to understand not understand, but we need to at least know about transports and protocols and futures. But this is how it would look like. One construct that we have not seen so far is the async with, which is very interesting. So this is a context manager. What this does is it allows us to do cleanup cleanly. Like we could, so for instance, if we exit the server, we could kill the tasks which are currently running, or it could close socket connections. So the async with is the equivalent of a context manager, but for programs built with async await, like asynchronous programs. The protocol, so these are details which are specific to async IO. These are not translate to the other libraries. So this is something you'll have to learn depending on what you want to use. This is an example from Curio. So Curio has been quite influential in how async IO in Python shapes up, because for instance, the run function is now available in mostly all libraries. That was initially conceived or first written by Curio. So I think it's an interesting framework. And what it does is it provides asynchronous equivalents of most of what's available in Python library. For instance, it wraps the entire socket module here. As I mentioned it previously, the author wants this to be a building block for others to build upon. And otherwise, yeah, I think the rest of the key syntax we have looked at. And lastly, the Trio example. I think what's interesting to note here is there's no socket anywhere. Right? It's visible here at the bottom. But all it's saying is provide me a TCP server which is listening on this port. So what I'm trying to say is Trio provides higher level abstractions than because then you can I think the argument is it's easier to get things correct with these higher level abstractions. Similarly, this here is a stream. Stream in Trio is like an abstraction again. It could represent a socket, or I think it could also represent like a SSL stream as well. Essentially, it's a abstraction over the underlying, like you don't worry about what's the underlying transport mechanism, sort of. So these are some. The first three links here are actually YouTube videos that you can look at if you find this interesting. But perhaps if you were to only look at one of these, I would say go for this blog post by Nathaniel, the author of Trio. I think it's very interesting to look at what are the problems when we do asynchronous programming, and is yeah, so if there's only one you would read out of this list, start here. But I would say all of them are interesting. So that's all I had. Any questions?
So, questions?
Yeah, hi. So my daughter thinks my job is really boring. Uh-huh. So can you show the stars table slide again so I can take a photo of it and send to her just to taunt her?
Awesome. I think that makes me very happy. And both Michael and Lucas also.
Thanks.
Sure.
More questions? If there are no more questions, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.